Well, thank you, Sophia, for those words of introduction. And also thank you to Coface for the invitation to speak to you this morning. The title that I've been given is Will Asia's Growth Momentum Continue? And I think the simple answer to that is that yes, we do expect it to continue. As Alicia talked about earlier on, there are a number of major macroeconomic factors that are going to impact the region. But strangely, I find myself in large agreement with her. That's largely because, as the Irish playwright George Bernard Shaw said, if you took all the economists in the world and laid them end to end, they'd never reach a conclusion. I think in this case, I think many economists are in agreement that we're looking at a global economy with a fairly subdued growth outlook. We've run through a number of different synonyms for subdued: lackluster, disappointing. The growth outlook for the world economy is indeed very subdued. We will see slower growth also in the emerging markets, but the main issues are that, as Alicia mentioned, we're seeing slower growth in global trade. Before the global financial crisis, global trade was growing at twice the rate of global GDP. Now it's just about growing at the same rate as global GDP. So that's having an impact, and we are seeing a lower growth outlook. On the back of that, lower commodities prices, the dollar strengthening, as Alicia has talked about, the China rebalancing story, these are all parts of the big picture. But despite that, emerging Asia will continue to expand, and we think it's going to remain one of the primary growth engines of the global economy. It's also a region that is pretty resilient against external vulnerabilities. And again, I think there's an interesting contrast with the situation in 1997-98, when many of the factors that we see now in terms of providing resilience for Asia didn't exist in those days. But there are still a few risk factors, and in the final three slides of my presentation, I'll talk about some of those. So, as I've mentioned, a subdued global growth outlook. Every quarter, we produce our so-called macro board report, which presents our forecast for the global economy, or at least for the G20. And every time we've produced that report, every quarter we've produced that report in the course of this year, we've ended up reducing our growth forecast for the global economy. For 2016, we expect to see a continued mild recovery in the U.S., certainly U.S. growth not picking up to its pre-crisis levels, but growing fairly solidly in the mid-2% range. The euro area, again, a slight growth pickup, and I think some of that will be down to euro weakness, which will, as Alessandro talked about earlier, it's good for the export sectors of Europe. But again, it's a pretty subdued outlook for Europe. Japan, we don't expect to see a big improvement in terms of growth there next year. And of course, then the big story really is China's ongoing growth slowdown. Other large emerging economies, such as Russia and Brazil, may experience either a continuation of their current recession or drop back into recession. So I think overall, this is a picture of a world economy which is growing, but growing very modestly. One of the results of the likely Fed tightening at the end of this year, we expect that the Fed will begin to raise rates either in December or early in 2016. One of the consequences of that is that there's a divergence in terms of monetary policy among the major central banks. We expect the Fed to start raising rates, but to do so in a relatively modest way. probably topping out at around 200 basis points of increases. That compares to 500 basis points in previous tightening cycles. So a slower, more modest tightening of Fed monetary policy. Meanwhile, the ECB and the Bank of Japan remain in easing mode, and we expect to see more monetary policy support in those parts of the world going forward. So what does all this mean for Asia? Well, first of all, the monetary policy divergence, I think, continues, that story continues across Asia. We're seeing in most countries in the region continued fairly muted inflationary pressure, and that's supporting monetary policy and easing in the region. As you can see in the chart on the left-hand side, many central banks around the region have already cut interest rates quite substantially in the course of this year. We expect further monetary easing to continue into 2016. Now, that's a very unusual situation, again, because normally what tends to happen when the Fed starts raising rates is that many other central banks around the world, including in the past Asian central banks, have generally moved in lockstep with the Fed. So as the Fed raises rates, they also raise rates. We are, in historical terms, looking at a very unusual situation of the Fed raising rates and continued monetary easing in Asia. One of the consequences of that will be continued US dollar strength, and that will exacerbate shifts that we've already seen in the course of this year in terms of foreign exchange and in terms of capital flows. And I'll talk a little bit about potential risks there a bit later on. Commodities prices, we think, are going to remain subdued. On the right-hand side of the slide, you can see the chart there for our forecast on the oil price. We expect that to remain pretty subdued, not recovering over $60 a barrel until probably sometime in 2017. That reflects substantial supply that has been and inventory overhangs, which we think will continue to weigh on the oil market. The same kind of story is true for other industrial commodities. And actually, for most emerging Asian economies, that's a good news story. Many of them are large commodities importers, and the decline in the price of oil has, for example, been a major boost to India's economic outlook. It's also a positive for countries like Korea and Japan, which are also large energy importers. And only a few countries in the region are really affected very much by the declining commodities prices, and they're countries like Malaysia and Indonesia. China's rebalancing is a key theme, and that, I mean, we're projecting that growth this year is going to be come out at 6.8%, falling to 6.3% next year, and by the time we get to the end of the decade, around 6, or possibly a little bit below 6. That reflects the rebalancing that's going on. Basically, what we've got in China is the story of two economies, old China and new China. Old China is facing increasing challenges in terms of overcapacity industries like mining and steel, and the traditional manufacturing base of China is under considerable pressure, as we see from the fact that producer prices have been in deflation for getting on for 4 years now. On the other side, the new China, the consumption and services driven side of the economy, is holding up relatively well. Consumption is holding up relatively well. We are seeing an expansion in terms of the services sector in China. So that's partially offsetting the slowdown that we see from the declines in old China. But given the relative sizes of these two parts of the economy, even a fairly solid pickup in terms of consumption and services is not really going to offset the downward pressure resulting from these traditional manufacturing industries and export industries. Investment is also a big part of the story here. We've seen a very substantial decline in fixed asset investment growth, and that has had an impact both in terms of China's growth, but also, of course, in terms of the commodities story, and it's a big part of the commodities story. So we've seen in the recent past companies and countries gearing up to provide raw materials for China's investment and in infrastructure in particular, And now that that has substantially declined, that's having a very substantial impact in terms of commodities, as I've already mentioned. We think that the Chinese authorities are now prioritizing stability over reform. That's partly a consequence of the events of the middle of the year, first of all the stock market, and then with the renminbi so-called devaluation. And that has led to, I think, a slight lessening of reform pace. Whether reform will pick up again once things stabilize is something that we're waiting to see. But certainly we think that now the priority is in terms of stabilizing growth. And that will mean that we'll see substantial additional policy support going forward. We've already seen substantial policy support to ensure that the growth outturn for this year is close to the government's official target, and we think that that's going to continue. These external headwinds are obviously going to affect Asia's economies, but I think the basic message here is that we think that emerging Asia is pretty resilient to these kinds of potential economic risks. As you can see on the left-hand side, we think that emerging Asia is going to outperform in terms of growth, certainly other major emerging economies. We have the world's fastest growing large economy in India, in the region. China, despite the growth slowdown, still continues to grow at a very solid rate by any standards. And I think that's true throughout much of emerging Asia. So we see quite a good growth story there. And then on the right-hand side, we've got a heat map which shows you Asia's resilience to possible external shocks. To what extent are Asian economies exposed to a potential balance of payments problem? Or would the government have difficulty in terms of funding itself in foreign currency? That's in the first four columns. And then in the final three columns, it's how much space do Asia's governments have to respond to a potential growth slowdown? Can they cut interest rates further? Could they provide fiscal stimulus if they need it? And basically the story from this heat map, certainly if you compare it to other parts of the world, is that Asia's economies are pretty resilient. The vulnerabilities to external shocks are pretty limited, and the ability of governments to respond with policy support in most cases are still quite substantial. So what are the risks? Well, I think there are three in particular. First of all, we've seen a very rapid increase in leverage throughout the emerging economies, and including Asia, since the global financial crisis, since 2008. Both internal, domestic, and external debt have grown quite substantially in Asia. And of course, if we were to see some kind of disruption in financial markets and a major repricing in terms of interest rates, that may have potentially serious consequences for those very highly indebted borrowers. Again, a few mitigating factors here. First of all, external debt in Asia is still comparatively low, and most of the borrowing that Asia's sovereigns have done since 2008 has been in domestic currency, and we recently published research on this showing how there has been a very substantial shift over the last 20 years from Asian governments borrowing in foreign currency, predominantly US dollars, to borrowing in their own currencies, and that obviously reduces risks. And I think in terms of the banking system, the banking systems across Asia are pretty resilient. Capital buffers are still quite strong. Liquidity buffers are still quite strong. So that's reflected in the fact that throughout most of the region, we have a stable outlook on the banking system. And that contrasts to the situation in quite a number of other regions around the world. The second downside risk is China's growth slowdown. There is a possibility, I wouldn't put it very high, but there is a possibility that we may see that China's growth slows down further than we are forecasting. Possible drivers for that? Well, we have seen stabilization in the property market. That's on the back of substantial government support, both at the end of last year and this year, to try to stabilize the real estate market. And that has been effective, but there is still a very large inventory overhang there, which is going to continue to drag on growth in China for some time. Obviously, if we did see a sharper slowdown in China, that would have an impact throughout the rest of Asia. There are substantial trade linkages between the rest of Asia and China, as we illustrate on the left-hand side of this chart, that a number of economies in the region do have quite high export exposures to China. So that the there would be a risk to those economies if we see a deeper downturn in China's growth than we're currently expecting. And of course, as I've already mentioned, many of the economies in the region do still have scope to ease monetary policy further and provide fiscal support to buffer these sorts of shocks. Other regions are also a risk factor. What goes on in the euro area does matter for Asia. It's a key source of demand for Asia, accounting for about 9.5% of Asia's total exports. So what happens in the euro area doesn't stay in the euro area. And if we were to see a resurfacing of problems in the euro area, that would certainly have a negative impact on Asia. We don't think that that is likely at the moment, but I think it is fair to say that despite what Alessandro was saying earlier, there is some residual risk in the euro area, and we don't believe that it's fully out of the woods at the moment. A final area of risk, I think, is that we get a disorderly response to Fed tightening. If interest rate expectations don't adjust smoothly, then we could see more volatility in capital flows. There could be even further downward pressure on Asian currencies and more difficult funding conditions across the region. And there is a sort of residual risk of that happening. If you look at what the Fed is projecting in terms of the future path of interest rates and what the market is expecting, there's about a 50 basis points of difference by the end of next year. The Fed thinks that monetary policy is going to be up about 50 basis points tighter than the market currently expects. So there is a bit of a divergence in terms of expectations at the moment, and if that were to unwind in a disorderly way, then we could have some negative impact on the region. But I think overall, just to go back to my initial overview, although we're looking at a slow growth across the global economy, subdued growth across the global economy, emerging Asia stands out as being one of the relatively few parts of the global economy where we still see a fairly strong growth performance, where the factors like the strength of government balance sheets, the strength of banking systems, really stand out as providing mitigating factors in the event that these global headwinds become stronger in the year ahead. So thank you very much for your attention.